Tak ještě jednou dobré odpoledne, moje jméno je Jan Majíček, jsem člen Socialistické solidarity a SOKu. Dovolte mi, abych vás přivítal na tomto druhém panelu. Náš druhý panel se bude jmenovat Manifest jako součást marxismu a máme tu tři řečníky. Tím prvním je Gregor Ritschel, ten působí na Akademii politických teorií a historických ideí Martina Luthera. A takže ho tady hezky vítám. Naším druhým řečníkem je Martin Brabec, který působí v Centru globálních studií Akademie věd. A třetím řečníkem je Juraj Halas z Bratislavy, který působí na Komenského univerzitě. No a já nebudu dále zdržovat a rovnou předám Georgovi Ritschelovi slovo. So, floor is yours.
So, thank you for your kind invitation. As you said, I'm a political scientist. What political scientists do is not just deal with international relations or comparative studies of systems. We also deal with the history of political ideas. And basically, that's what I do in my dissertation. I put Marx in context, concrete, put it into the context of this sort of the 19th century. In this case, did a comparative study on Marx and Jeremy Bentham. So, Jeremy Bentham and Karl Marx broke through the self-referential debate of philosophy. Seldom you will find two political thinkers who unfolded such a vast history of reception and had such a great influence and such enormous influence on social movements. In their temporal closeness, one can find some similarities, but both are commonly perceived as two thinkers with rather divergent worldviews. Marx's caustic remark on Bentham in his Capital is widely known, and he writes on him, "Classical economy always loved to conceive social capital as a fixed magnitude of a fixed degree of efficiency, but this prejudice was first established as a dogma by the arch-philistine Jeremy Bentham, that insipid, pedantic, lesser-tongued oracle of the ordinary bourgeois intelligence of the 19th century." However, today we are talking about the Communist Manifesto. In my perspective, we can find some striking similarities between both thinkers. Those similarities led me to question Marx's polemics. Isn't it the case that we most often have the strongest trouble with our direct neighbors? Maybe Marx criticized Bentham so vehemently because that he felt that their theories had a certain amount in common. A few of us might know it was quite common for Marx to launch his most aggressive attacks on other socialists. Despite Marx's polemics on Bentham, it is Bentham's principle of the happiness of the greatest number which doesn't seem to be too far away from Marx's thought. Especially in the Communist Manifesto, many arguments can be found which are based in the interest of the majority. I think this quote was quoted before here. Marx and Engels writes, all previous historical movements were movements of minorities or in the interest of minorities. The proletarian movement is the self-conscious, independent movement of immense majority in the interest of the immense majority. The proletariat, the lowest stratum of our present society, cannot stir, cannot raise itself up without the whole super incumbent strata officially sprung, strata of the official society being sprung into the air. Or Marx formulates in another quote, "You are horrified at our intending to do away with private property. But in your existing society, private property is already done away with 9/10 of the population. Its existence for the few is solely due to its non-existence in the hands of 9/10. You reproach us, therefore, with intending to do away with a form of property. The necessary condition for Woe's existence is the non-existence of any property for the immense majority of the society. So Marx based his argument on numbers. If one compares the independent movement of the immense majority and the interest of the immense majority with Bentham's formula of the happiness of the largest number, both authors suddenly seem to be close to each other. Suddenly, the revolutionary Marx appears to be the neighbor of the reformer Bentham. In my view, both Jeremy Bentham and Karl Marx, despite their different approaches, were driven by democratic principles. Both questioned privileged minorities, both were looking for ways to equal freedom of all individuals. So you may be familiar with Marx, but what did Bentham do, in a nutshell? Bentham was born in London in 1748, trained as a lawyer. He criticized the idea of natural law, and especially the famous legal scholar William Blackstone. For Bentham, only human-made law, so-called positive law, was real. In the middle years, he promoted the idea of the panopticum, which he developed together with his brother Samuel during a stay in Russia between 1786 and 1787, where his brother, on behalf of Catherine the Great, developed and built military ships. The panopticum was invented as a simple surveillance platform. Jeremy Bentham reformulated the idea and applied it to all other social institutions you can think of, like schools or hospitals. Around 1800, he failed with his attempt to implement the prison panopticum in the English society. In his eyes, this was due to corrupt aristocratic elites, and especially King George III. In the following years, Bentham vehemently criticized their so-called sinister interest and the lack of transparency in common law and English politics. In the 1920s and the 1930s, he was the head of a movement called Philosophical Radicals, which were known for their progressive views. Together with James Mill, the father of John Stuart Mill, he founded a newspaper called Westminster Review in 1823. Also, the old Bentham outlined a plan for a modern representative parliamentary system in which every voice should be heard equally. He died in 1832. Marx and Bentham's common ground can be formulated in the following way. Both opposed an undemocratic excess of political power that they believed to exist in concrete minorities of specific historic formations. While Bentham fought aristocracy and its political dominance, Marx, only a few decades later, criticized the bourgeois system and its system for its underlying social inequality. Both criticized veiled privileges incompatible with democracy. So what about Marx's polemics against Bentham? Might they be explained by the fact that Marx believed that he had found ideological competitor which converted rather similar insights to false conclusions? As Georg Kramer McInnes points out, like Marx, Bentham was a radical essayist, a materialist, and a democrat. So the tension between Bentham and Marx can be clarified by looking more closely at the early work of Marx and Engels. Bentham and Marx both became famous for their social critique as well as for their critique of religion and the church. Marx's critique of religion best shows us why and how Marx criticized Bentham based upon what he knew about him. In his writings on religion, Marx referred to the Christian teaching of otherworldly salvation. Marx told the reader that the suffering makes people seek relief in the opium of religion and that their pain drives them into the illusory happiness of afterlife. In order to attain true happiness, However, Marx argued that it was necessary to turn to the actual social problems causing the pain. Marx writes in his introduction to a contribution to the critique of Hegel's philosophy of right, religious distress, it is at the same time the expression of real distress, also the protest against real distress. Religion is the sigh of the oppressed creature, the heart of the heartless world, just as it is the spirit of the spiritless condition. It is the opium of the people. To abolish religion as a illusory happiness of the people is to demand their real happiness. The demand to give up illusions about existing state of affairs is the demand to give up the state of affairs which needs illusions. Thus the criticism of heaven turns into the criticism of the earth, the criticism of religion into the criticism of law, and the criticism of theology into the criticism of politics. This quote suggests that real happiness, in contrast to illusory happiness of the afterlife, should be anticipated in this life. Happiness was not to represent a mere idea, rather it should be the result of social change, a change of practice and a change of habits. From this point of view, Bentham's writings do not seem to be too far away from Marx's position, while Bentham did not consider himself a revolutionary. However, for the young Bentham, only individuals could and should define what happiness meant to them. The individual citizen and the equality between them were crucial for his ideal. His disciple, John Stuart Mill, presented Bentham's political ideas in the sentence, "Everybody to count for one, nobody for more than one." In Bentham's later writings, he wrote about the sinister interest of the ruling few that could have delusive effects on larger parts of the population. Here, political elites produce misleading definitions of a happy life that only appear to be reasonable for all. Within this paradigm of moral anthropology, Bentham shed light on various forms of persuasive speech. One of Bentham's biographers, Charles Milner Atkinson, summarizes Bentham's analytical comments regarding his political antagonists in Bentham's Handbook of Political Fallacies in the following amusing way. And here you might see some similarities to Marx. The Book of Fallacies consists of a laborious but incisive exposure of many mischievous absurdities which passed current as good sense in political assemblies. And it was directly mainly against devices made use in support of corruption and arbitrary power. Thus Bentham ridiculous appeals of the wisdom of our ancestors, so-called Chinese argument, the hobgoblin argument, no innovation, the procrastinator's argument, wait a little, this is not a time, the snail's pace argument, one thing at a time, not so fast, slow and sure, and so on. Fallacies of confusion are so admirably dealt with, for example, the use of imposture terms applied to the defense of things which under their proper name are manifestly indefensible. So, in the light of this, one may argue that Bentham began to confront a phenomenon of ideology in a similar way as Marx would do several decades later. British historian John Dinwiddie wrote on the comparison between both in the following way. Had Marx read the later fully radicalized Bentham, he would still, no doubt, have regarded him as an essential bourgeois kind of former. But he might have recognized nonetheless that their respective theories had a certain amount in common. This was particularly true in the area one might call social psychology of politics, one of the most interesting respects in which Bentham anticipated Marx was in his perception that people's behaviors and ideas and beliefs are largely conditioned by their social situations. John Stuart Mill, in the famous essay on Bentham in 1833, praised him for having drawn attention to the so-called selfish interest in form of the class interest. and for having identified the phenomenon which Bentham called interest-begotten prejudice. For showing, in other words, how a ruling class or elite will develop, to a large extent unconsciously, beliefs and ideas that suit and support their own collective interests. Bentham admitted that one could not always predict how an individual would think and behave from examining their social situations. But he considered that the behavior of groups was almost invariably determined by their self-regarding interests, and that the larger the group was, the more confidently this rule could be applied. So still, a fundamentally discrepancy between both thinkers can be identified here. Marx's critique of illusory happiness tells us that all humans are led by public imaginations. Perceptions of happiness for Marx are much less a private matter than it was for Bentham, or the early Bentham. According to Marx, the idea of otherworldly salvation was, culturally shared conception, which he believed to serve the interest of the ruling classes. An empirical approach that exclusively considers the individual pursuit of happiness would therefore be misleading, since in reality, individual actors and social structures influence each other all the time. This is precisely the criticism that Marx and Engels formulate against Bentham, or rather their version of Bentham. So Engels wrote in an article for the social democratic paper Vorwärts in 1844, in which he referred to the contemporary debates in England and also to Bentham, the following words, which kind of summarizes the failure of Bentham. Bentham takes the essentially social nature of his principle, the principle of utility, further in accordance with the national trend of that time and makes individual interest the basis of the general interest, or volonté générale, allgemeinwohl. Bentham here makes the same error in his empiricism that Hegel made in his theory. He does not seriously try to overcome these contradictions. He turns the subject into the predicate, subordinates the whole to the part, and in doing so stands everything on its head. First he says general and individual interests are inseparable, and then he stays unilaterally at the crudest individual interest. So Engels and Marx dismissed Bentham's assumption that the common good equals the sum of the individual interests, which Marx and Engels say, like Bentham conceptualized as a bourgeois and therefore egoistic disposition. But nevertheless, in their manifesto, Marx and Engels proclaimed in their manifesto that, quote, the free development of each is the condition for the free development of all, quote end. And this is kind of a key statement, one could argue, that shows that their focus on the individual interest somehow resembles Bentham's idea of individualism. In both cases, nobody should remain unfree, and freedom should be universal. But at the same time, Marx criticized Bentham for his certain idea of individualism as a form of a methodological individualism as well as a bourgeois lifestyle. So, skip something. In contrast to Bentham's more or less bourgeois idea of individualism, Marx promoted individuality in a sense of a free development for all, like also Varoufakis points out. This idea might be inspired by the ancient Greek philosophers like Aristotle, but Marx's idea of the modern individuality could only be reached through the abolition of market order, wage labor, and alienation. So let's jump to the conclusion. Marx and Engels found harsh words for Bentham, but their remarks on Bentham's were not exclusively negative. Marx's efforts concerning a society-based form of democratization can be read as a continuation of Bentham's democratization project and its aim to establish a civil rights-based state in which every voice should be heard equally. While the reformers Bentham attacked the aristocracy and its hegemony within the sphere of British politics, the revolutionary Marx attacked the bourgeois state that had established itself by the time to some extent in defense of the proletariat. Both fought for forms of democracy in different ways and in different historical contexts. However, Marx's polemics against the genius of bourgeois stupidity were not so much aimed at Bentham as a person. Rather, Marx's polemics intended to attack the bourgeois market beliefs of that time, and like Marx's works, I think from The Capital, is they alone rule freedom, equality, property, and Bentham. Bentham, because each looks only to himself, criticized the system to Woolf's ancestor. He stylized Bentham as an arch-Philistine. But besides this, Marx and Engels came to an ambivalent assessment of Bentham's utilitarianism and of course, the Chartist movement. In The Condition of the Working Class, a book from Engels from 1845, Engels described Bentham and his philosophy as an important stepping stone in the evolution of the Chartist movement. And he writes, "The two great practical philosophers of the latest date, Bentham and Goodwin, are, especially the latter, almost exclusively the property of the proletariat. For though Bentham has a school within the radical bourgeoisie, it's only the proletariat and the socialists who have succeeded in developing his teachings a step forward." Thank you.
Děkuju moc Gregorovi za jeho příspěvek, který nás uvedl tedy do toho světa, ve kterém se rodily ty první polemiky a které dali vzniknout některým prvkům, které pak v manifestu najdeme. A já bych rovnou přešel k dalšímu řečníkovi, který nás uvede do současnější debaty, a to je Martin Brabec, který nám poví tedy o politickém marxismu a o tom, jak politický marxismus čte komunistický manifest.
Hezké odpoledne, jsem slyšet, mluví to. Já budu hovořit o politickém marxismu a jeho vztahu ke komunistickému manifestu, ale nejprve zdůrazním tu specifičnost politického marxismu pohledu na kapitalismus. Je to slyšet? Politický marxismus je proud, relativně moderní proud marxismu, současné marxismu, i když své kořeny už má v 70. letech. Já jenom stručně zmíním tu jeho historii, protože v mém příspěvku pak uvidíte tu jeho specifičnost. Politický marxismus je proud, který vznikl na základě teorií vzniku kapitalismu anglického nebo amerického historika Roberta Brennera a kanadské politoložky Ellen Woodové, která pak rozpracovávala ty Brennerovy koncepce původu kapitalismu a aplikovala je na různé aspekty jak vývoje kapitalismu, tak rozboru jednotlivých společensko-ekonomických formacích. Takže už v 70. letech Brenner přišel s tou svojí teorií kapitalismu, o které budu hovořit. Woodová ji dále rozvíjela a postupně nabalovalo se na ně jejich další žáci. Ty žáci jsou dneska i významnými akademiky na různých univerzitách a rozpracovávají právě na základě Brennerova pojetí kapitalismu například anglickou průmyslovou revoluci nebo americkou revoluci, vznik kapitalismu ve Spojených státech, nebo další významná knížka byla třeba Francouzská revoluce právě z pohledu toho politického marxismu. Ten název politický marxismus je možná trošku nešťastný, protože to je termín, kterým ho označili kritici, a to z toho důvodu, že právě kladl velký důraz podle kritiků nikoliv na ekonomické determinanty při přechodu z feudalismu na kapitalismus, ale na politické momenty, na třídní boj, což se některým tím marxistickým kritikům zdálo příliš nahodilé, jo? Že v tom Brennerově pohledu je velká nahodilost. Možná je, uvidíme sami. Takže Brenner a Woodová stály v základu toho politického marxismu. Tady možná někdy dochází k záměně politického marxismu s analytickým marxismem. Analytický marxismus, ten také vznikl v 70. letech a Brenner byl také členem toho analytického marxismu. Ale ten analytický marxismus vlastně neměl, bych řekl, neměl nějaké společné obsahové jádro. To byli teoretici, kteří byli ovlivněni rozvojem sociálních metod v tehdejší době, jako byla teorie rational choice a metodologický individualismus a analytická filozofie obecně v anglosaském světě a snažili se to aplikovat na Marxe a zjistit, které pojmy či které teorie jsou u Marxe udržitelné ještě ve světle těchto moderních teorií. Brenner byl součástí tohohle kruhu, ale zároveň se ti teoretici rozcházeli a Brenner tam byl ve sporu s dalším významným zakladatelem analytického marxismu, Geraldem Cohenem, což byl anglický politický filozof. Já ještě zmíním ve svém příspěvku tu jeho kritiku Cohena. Takže tím základem politického marxismu je pohled na vznik kapitalismu a v čem spočívá specifičnost kapitalismu. A právě tato specifičnost pohledu na kapitalismu se pak promítne také v pohledu politického marxismu na komunistický manifest. Brenner i Woodová kritizují takzvaný konvenční způsob výkladu kapitalismu, jak to nazývají, a ten konvenční výklad způsobu kapitalismu je ovlivněn podle Brennera a Woodové velmi často Smithem, Adamem Smithem. Také tady je slavný článek Brennera Smithovský marxismus. Tenhle smithovský pohled na vznik kapitalismu vychází z toho, že vlastně lidé mají nějakou tendenci obchodovat, směňovat, že to je prostě nějaká lidská přirozenost, která je transhistorická, která přechází přes všechny dějné etapy. A tudíž tato tendence potřebuje být osvobozena. Potřebuje být osvobozena od různých tlaků, například od nějakého autokratického státu nebo parazitické moci panstva nebo od tlaků ideologických, jako je třeba náboženství. Ale v člověku se projevuje tato tendence. Tak když se odstraní, tak vlastně začne vznikat kapitalismus. Takže tady už vidíte, že kapitalismus je spojen s nějakým obchodováním, směňováním, kde najdeme nějaký obchod, směnu, a odstraněné překážky obchodování směnu, tam podle tohohle výkladu už vlastně najdeme nějaké počátky kapitalismu. Tomuhle modelu se také někdy říká komerční model. Mimochodem, tenhle model najdeme určitě i v komunistickém manifestu. Jo? Tam se projevuje velmi výrazně. Tím, že se tady objevily nové trhy, tam hovoří Marx, Amerika, tak se začíná obchodovat. Jo? A jako implicitně nebo možná explicitně tam vzniká kapitalismus. Další verze tohoto konvenčního modelu vychází z toho, že je tady nějaká transhistorická tendence k rozvoji výrobních sil, že se neustále v dějinách rozvíjí výrobní síly. Tenhle model mimochodem zastával Gerald Cohen, jo, ve své práci Obrana Marxovy teorie dějin ze 70. let. A právě s tímhle modelem polemizuje Brenner. Brenner i s Woodovou vlastně chtějí ukázat, že tomu tak není, že naopak kapitalismus tím, že spočívá v nějakých specifických společensko-vlastnických vztazích, tak teprve kapitalismus umožňuje až nějaký rozvoj, radikální rozvoj výrobních sil. Nikoliv, že tady existuje ekonomický rozvoj výrobních sil skrze všechny lidské nebo všechny společenské formace. Takže Brenner s Woodovou se vymezuje vůči tomuhle pojetí, které najdeme velmi silně, tedy i v komunistickém manifestu. Tenhle model podle politického marxismu zastírá specifičnost kapitalismu. Zastírá specifičnost v tom, čem kapitalismus počívá. Vlastně jako kdyby ten kapitalismus tady byl od jak těživa. Jo? Od jak těživa, jenom jsou tady nějaké zábrany společenské, ideologické, které brání, aby se ten kapitalismus projevil. Tato diskuze má starší kořeny ještě než Brennerovi. Už v 50. letech proběhla velmi významná diskuze mezi americkým ekonomem Sweezym a anglickým historikem, nebo také ekonomem možná Dobem. A ti se přeli právě o původ kapitalismu. Sweezy zdůrazňoval, že kapitalismus má své počátky v růstu obchodu díky objevům nových zemích při vzniku kapitalismu. A Sweezy právě kladl důraz na růst dělby práce, specializaci, konkurenci. Takže kladl důraz na takzvané externí faktory. Naopak Dob říkal, že počátky vzniku kapitalismu musíme hledat v samotném feudalismu. Musíme je hledat v samotných tendencích feudalismu ke krizím, a to především v úsilí vládnoucí třídy po největších ziscích, po vytěžování co největších zisků. Plus také kladl důraz na tendenci k růstu populace a ještě dalším faktorům. Ale to tady nebudu rozbírat teď do detailu. Takže to už byla první předzvěst té debaty. Brenner se tady staví na pozici doba, i když ho v některých aspektech kritizuje. A pak tady nastala významná diskuse v 70. letech, kdy Brenner napadl významného historika Wallersteina právě za to, že Wallerstein klade důraz také na vznik obchodu, na původ obchodu nebo na obchod jako původ vzniku kapitalismu. Na obchodování jako faktor, který vede ke vzniku kapitalismu. Brenner tady vytýká Wallersteinovi, že vlastně Wallerstein kolikrát předpokládá, že už ti aktéři, kteří se tam objevují, že už to jsou kapitalističtí aktéři. Že už vlastně akumulují. A Brenner se ptá, proč najednou teď musí akumulovat? Když dříve neakumulovali, proč najednou musí akumulovat? Nebo proč nevyužívají ten získaný nadprodukt? Proč ho neužívají neefektivně? Proč ho neužívají pro luxusní zboží nebo pro válečné výdaje? Proč ho najednou začínají využívat pro výrobu? Takže vlastně Wallerstein ve svých analýzách předpokládá něco, co měl teprve vysvětlit. Že měl vysvětlit vznik toho ekonomického kapitalistického aktéra. Tak, jak vidí Brenner ty předkapitalistické výrobní vztahy, co je jejich rysem a jak se pak odlišují právě od těch rysů kapitalistických. Tak, základním rysem předkapitalistických výrobních vztahů, který ovlivňuje ekonomickou racionalitu jednotlivých aktérů, je skutečnost, že výrobci mají přímý přístup k prostředkům obživy. Výrobci nejsou nuceni je nakupovat na trhu. Z toho plynou dvě důležité věci. Za prvé, tím, že nebyli nuceni prodávat na pracovním trhu svoji pracovní sílu, tak tento pracovní trh byl velmi omezený, neposkytoval potenciál pro kooperaci a úspory z rozsahu. Za druhé, výrobci také nebyli vystaveni nutnosti prodávat na trzích za konkurenceschopnou cenu svoji produkci, což je právě nemotivovalo ke snižování nákladů, ani k akumulaci, ani k inovaci, ani k dělbě práce. Stejně byla zbavena závislosti na trhu i šlechta. Nemusela samozřejmě prodávat svoji pracovní sílu, tak ani výrobky na trhu, protože prostředky k obživě získávala mimo ekonomickým násilným tlakem na výrobce. Tito výrobci byli vystaveni násilnému odebrání části produktu. To však vedlo k tomu, že výrobci předkapitalistických společnostech neměli motivaci ke zvyšování produktivity. Pokud šlechta chtěla zvyšovat produkci, mohla tak učinit pouze a pouze přímým donucením. Nemohla používat například hrozbu propuštění, což je velmi efektivní prostředek, který se používá k disciplinaci práce v kapitalistických společnostech. A přímé donucení bylo velmi nákladné, jelikož vyžadovalo neustálý dohled. Šlechta tak neměla k dispozici žádnou ekonomickou pobídku, jak přimět rolníky, aby efektivně pracovali, protože rolníci již vlastnili prostředky k obživě a museli by být placeni ekvivalentem své práce. Jinak by pro ně bylo vhodnější energii a čas věnovat práci na svém vlastním pozemku. To by však pro šlechtu nemělo smysl, protože by tak musela zaplatit ekvivalent toho, co dostává. To je danou práci. Jinak řečeno, v této situaci nebylo možné vykořisťovat směnou pracovní síly za mzdu. To vedlo k tomu, že šlechta místo do rozvoje výrobních prostředků investovala do prostředků donucovacích či do spotřeby luxusního zboží. Podle Brennera tak v těchto předkapitalistických společnostech neexistoval žádný systematický tlak a tendence k rozvoji výrobních sil. Jak je tomu však v kapitalismu? Produktivita kapitalismu nevychází primárně z rozvoje technologie, jak třeba tvrdil Cohen, či z metod organizace práce, ale právě za systematického a stálého tlaku konkurence, který nutí aktéry redukovat náklady, akumulovat, investovat, snižovat náklady. V kapitalismu jsou výrobci zbaveni přístupu k prostředkům obživy a na trhu jsou tak nuceni kupovat jak nástroje k výrobě, tak i zdroje k obživě. Stejně tak musí být schopni prodávat na trhu za konkurenční cenu produkty své práce. Kapitalistické vztahy, tržní vztahy tedy, nutí výrobce inovovat, aby přežili na konkurenčním trhu, kam se snaží vstoupit další konkurenti s novou a lepší technologií, díky které mohou prodávat za nižší ceny. Za feudalismu všechny tyhle podněty schází, protože jak podaní, tak ani šlechtice nic k inovacím nemotivuje. Proč došlo k tomuhle přerodu, k té závislosti na trhu? Mimochodem, to je klíčový moment. Všichni aktéři v kapitalismu jsou závislí na trhu. Brenner s Woodovou vidí kapitalismus a trh jako něco, co je nutné, co vynucuje. Nikoliv nevidí trh jako něco, kde máte možnost prodávat. Ne, trh je něco, kde musíte prodávat. Abyste přežili, tak musíte prodávat na trhu. Nikoliv, že můžete prodávat na trhu. Ježišmarja, já mluvím pomalu, protože kvůli překladateli, tak... Počátky vzniku kapitalismu vidí Brenner v Evropě ve 14. století, kdy vypukl Černý mor. Při odhadovaném tehdejším počtu obyvatel 70 milionů padlo za oběť během první morové války v letech 1347 až 1352 18 milionů obyvatel. To vedlo ke snížení počtu podaných a tím i výši dávek, které odváděly šlechtě. Na tuto situaci šlechta reagovala tím, že se snažila zvýšit výši odvodu a poplatku a omezit volný pohyb nevolníků. To však vyvolalo mezi nevolníky silné nepokoje, jejichž důsledky se lišily ve východní a západní Evropě. Nejprve východní Evropu se podívejme. Ve východní Evropě nebyli nevolníci dostatečně organizováni, šlechta ve své snaze zvýšit vykořisťování uspěla, mimo ekonomické vykořisťování, myslím samozřejmě, a zavedla takzvané druhé nevolnictví. To vedlo k tomu, že ve východní Evropě se nerozvíjely výrobní síly. Konkurence zde byla minimální, protože, jak už jsme si řekli, feudální panství nezávisí při své reprodukci na trhu. Druhé nevolnictví tak ve východní Evropě vedlo k rozvoji zaostalosti. V západní Evropě byl však vývoj odlišný. Střety mezi šlechtou a nevolníky se ale projevovaly také odlišně v Anglii a ve Francii, a to je velmi důležité i při pohledu na komunistický manifest. V Anglii se nevolníkům podařilo dosáhnout toho, že nebyli přímo vykořisťováni, mimo ekonomicky vykořisťováni šlechtou. Ale šlechtě se podařilo co? Že se spojila se státem a vyvlastnila nevolníky z půdy. Nevolníci přišli o závislost nebo přístup k půdě, mimotržní přístup k půdě. To je to známé zabírání obecních pastvin. Půda se tak koncentrovala v rukou šlechty, která tuhle půdu pronajímala agrárním kapitalistům a agrární kapitalisté si najímali rolníky jako námezdí pracovní sílu. Tak začaly vznikat vlastně kapitalistické vztahy prvně kde? Na anglickém venkově, podle Brennera. Jo? Takže ta teze Brennera je, že kapitalismus má svůj původ nikoli v obchodě, nikoli ve městě, ale právě na venkově v kapitalismu. Jo? Kapitalismus vzniká na venkově. A vidíte tady co? Že první kapitalisté vlastně nebyli kapitalista versus šlechtic, ale že první kapitalisté v Anglii byli vlastně šlechtici, vlastníci půdy, kteří tuto půdu pronajímali agrárním kapitalistům a ti pak zase rolníkům. Ve Francii byla situace velmi odlišná. Rolníci si zachovali nezávislost vůči šlechtě, a to díky povaze francouzského státu, který silně závisel na daních, a tento stát se proto snažil omezit moc šlechty nad rolníky, konkrétně moc šlechty vybírat od rolníku rentu. Francouzská šlechta nebyla tak dost silná na to, aby vyvlastnila rolníky a přeměnila je na námezdně pracující, jak se to podařilo šlechtě anglické. To vedlo k čemu? To vedlo k takové dlouhodobé zaostalosti. Brenner tady říká, vlastně upozorňuje na zajímavý paradox, že svoboda a vlastnická práva francouzských rolníků vedla k chudobě a zaostalosti, zatímco naopak absence těchto práv zajistila Anglii ekonomický rozvoj. Ve Francii tedy byli pak rolníci vykořisťováni skrze francouzský stát. Šlechta se pak usiluje o pozice, o místa ve státě, v absolutistickém státě. A právě skrze tato místa a zdanění, státní zdanění, vlastně získává nadprodukt od rolníků. Jo? Takže tady vidíte úplně jiný přístup nebo jiný typ vykořisťování, který probíhá v Anglii, a jiný typ vykořisťování i třídní struktura, která vznikla ve Francii. Tak, teď už jenom poslední bod, a to je právě, to souvisí s tímhle rozdílem mezi Francií a Anglií. Když Marx rozebírá v manifestu revoluce, tak vlastně jeho vzorem revoluce je vlastně Francie. Ale Francie, jak jsme si teď řekla, se radikálně lišila její třídní struktura, ekonomická struktura od anglické třídní struktury a ekonomické. Francie byla tedy v 18. století a Marx vlastně, když popisuje revoluci, tak tedy čerpá z francouzské revoluce. A když mluví o buržuazii, tak tedy vlastně má na mysli tu francouzskou buržuazii. Ale tady je důležité si uvědomit, že nesmíme zaměňovat buržuazii za kapitalisty. Politický marxismus říká, že buržuazie a kapitalisté jsou něco jiného. A právě buržuazie souvisí s francouzským typem politického a ekonomického režimu v tom 18. století. Francie byla v 18. století absolutistickým státem, který byl nejenom politickou formou, ale byl zároveň ekonomickým zdrojem, z něhož čerpala vládoucí třída. Byl to centralizovaný nástroj neekonomického dobývání nadproduktu. A státní úřad byl vlastně formou vlastnictví, která jeho držitelům umožňovala dostat se k nadproduktu vytvořeným rolníky. To bylo ve výrazném protikladu k ekonomickému přivlastňování nadproduktu v Anglii. Francie se v té době vyznačovala rolnickou společností, která měla velmi omezené, fragmentarizované trhy, které se vůbec neřídily kapitalistickými principy. Buržuazie, kterou Marx vlastně viděl jako třídu, která usiluje o svržení monarchie, vlastně ve Francii, tou buržuazii, tu tvořili spíše takzvaní profesionálové, jak to nazývá, to znamená právníci, nějaký řemeslníci ve městech, ale odborné profese. Buržuazie ve Francii to nebyli kapitalisté. Buržuazii ve Francii šlo o to, aby se vlastně otevřela občanská rovnost. Ta buržuazie ve Francii už usilovala o otevřené kariéry pro talentované lidi. Rovnost k přístupu ke státním úřadům. Ta buržuazie ve Francii kritizovala aristokratická privilegia, která si monopolizovala místa ve státní správě. Buržuazie také hlásala určitý univerzalismus vůči partikularismu šlechty a církve. Ale ta francouzská buržuazie, to nebyli kapitalisté, to nebyli anglický kapitalisté, tak jak existovali na tom anglickém venkově. Takže Marx vlastně v komunistickém manifestu, i když hovoří o buržuazii, tak vlastně si bere inspiraci z Francie, nikoli z té kapitalistické Anglie. Děkuju za pozornost a možná v diskuzi ještě něco osvětlím.
Tak děkuju, Martine, za tohle přibližení debaty. No a nyní bych předal slovo Jurajovi Halasovi z Univerzity Komenského, a ten by se na manifest podíval ještě jinou optikou, a to manifest versus kapitál a pojímání kapitalismu, který tedy plně naváže na to, co tady Martin představil. Takže Juraj, máš slovo.
Thank you kindly for the invitation. The objective of my talk is rather simple. I want to point out some of the differences that there are, or I think there are, between the analysis of capitalism that underlies the Communist Manifesto, published in 1848, and the analysis of capitalism that is presented by Marx almost 20 years later in the first volume, especially in the first volume of Capital. I think the differences there between these two works are actually considerable, so considerable that they warrant us to speak about two different theories of capitalism, one from 1848 and one from the later Capital and the other economic or critical economic manuscripts by Marx. So in this sense, I agree with what Mr. Trenkle said in the first panel, that the Communist Manifesto is obsolete. I think that for different reasons than Mr. Trenkle, but I agree it's obsolete, and I think it was already obsolete in the 1860s, because Marx's Capital, the analysis of capitalism presented in Marx's Capital, actually made the manifesto obsolete. So I want to look at three different areas of differences in the analysis of capitalism in the manifesto and in Capital. The first will concern the origin of capitalism, and I will try to keep it very brief because it actually relates very closely to what Martin was talking about in the previous talk. The second area concerns the long-term perspectives of capitalist development, especially with relation to the position of the working class inside capitalism, and in relation to what the working class may expect from the future development of the capitalist mode of production. And the third area concerns the very nature of social reality and social relations in capitalism, and our ability of knowing this reality. As you can see, there are some brief keywords that summarize the differences. So with regard to origin of capitalism, we can say that the manifesto contains the commercialized or commercialization model of explaining the emergence of capitalism, while the explanation of the emergence of capitalism in Capital is based on something completely different, massive expropriation of the peasant population and a massive transformation of the relations of production in post-feudal Britain. As regards the long-term perspectives of capitalism, the differences between a theory of absolute and relative immiseration in the manifesto and Capital, respectively. And with regards to the third area, while the manifesto thinks that we can know the social reality of capitalism simply by looking at it with sober senses, the view in Capital is much more complex, because Capital argues that the social reality of capitalism is thoroughly mystified and fetishized, and therefore we need to look beyond what is immediately obvious, and we need a scientific analysis of this reality. So as I said, I'd like to just very briefly go through the story of the emergence of capitalism as it is presented in the first part of the manifesto. I want to point out some two or three quite simple things. You can see in the first paragraph, the thesis is that the first elements of the bourgeoisie appeared in feudal towns. The second paragraph stresses the role of trade, the increase in the means of exchange and in commodities generally, and all the other things that Martin was speaking about with regard to the commercialization model that stresses the role of trade and geographical expansion. And the third paragraph from Manifesto says that the first forms of modern capitalist industry emerged out of competition with feudal industry. Feudal industry was unable to cope with the rising demand that was the result of all these geographical discoveries and the opening of new markets, and ultimately it lost to the first shoots of modern capitalist industry in the form of manufactures. And the same movement repeated itself. The markets kept growing, the demand was rising, so even manufacture no longer sufficed, and thereupon there was the Industrial Revolution, which revolutionized industrial production. The story in Capital is completely different from this. First of all, Marx stresses that money and commodities, or money and commodity circulation, are not capital or are not capitalist in themselves. They need to be transformed into capital. And to do that, some very specific historical conditions have to be met. First of all, The capital relation presupposes a complete separation between the workers and the ownership of the conditions for the realization of their labor. So what must have happened before capital could have emerged was there had to be a massive expropriation of the immediate producers, which led to their separation from the means of production and the means of subsistence. So Marx says the process which creates the capital relation is this process of the divorce of the worker from the ownership of the conditions of his own labor. The other factors that were mentioned in the manifesto, like trade or geographical discoveries, they do play a role in capital. Marx mentions them, but the view is completely changed. They are no longer sufficient conditions for the emergence of capital. They are simply necessary conditions, which are not sufficient in themselves, nor in conjunction. The key missing factor that it's not even mentioned in the manifesto is the expropriation, this massive transformation or change or revolutionary rupture in the means in the relations of production. So while in the manifesto the main explanatory factor is the quantitative extension of trade, the specific role of towns and urbanization in capital, the key condition is the expropriation of immediate producers, which first happened in the British countryside through the clearing of the estates and all these other processes. And this happened in the countryside, not in the town. So urbanization and towns begin to play an important role in capitalism only later on the basis of this expropriation that first occurred in the countryside. Okay, let's quickly turn to the second area, the long-term perspectives of capitalism in the manifesto. The first thing that springs to mind is the theory of wages that is implicit in the manifesto. Marx and Engels state that the cost of production of a workman, i.e. the worker's wage, is restricted almost entirely to the means of subsistence that the worker requires for his own maintenance or perhaps for the maintenance of his family. They then go on to say that in the long term, in the process of long-term capitalist development, the modern laborer, instead of rising with the process of industry, sinks deeper and deeper below the conditions of existence of his own class. So he becomes a pauper, and pauperism develops more rapidly than population and wealth. So if we read this literally, this says the following thing: the rate of growth of pauperism in modern capitalism is greater than the rate of growth of population and the rate of growth of total product or of wealth. And they then go on to say that this has political consequences, political implications. The ruling class in capitalism becomes unable to rule because of this, because it is incompetent to assure an existence to its slave. It can no longer feed the class over which it wants to dominate, and therefore capitalism becomes untenable because the working class is unable to reproduce. In Capital, the things that Marx says are in complete contradiction with this. He first forcefully denies that the wage is determined by a physical minimum necessary for a worker's reproduction. He says, This is below the value of labor power. If the wage sinks to this level of physical subsistence, then it sinks below the value. This is something abnormal. This is something that cannot go on perpetually. And if this happens and is generalized to the working class as a whole, then sooner or later, capital will be forced to pay higher wages because otherwise it will be unable to produce. So Marx says the determination of the value of labor power is not simply subsistence. It also contains a historical and moral element. And this is something that changes in history. In other words, the extent of needs that are considered as necessary for the reproduction of labor power in its normal quality changes historically. So there's no eternal subsistence level for the working class throughout capitalist history. And not so much in Capital, but more in the Value, Price, and Profit pamphlet, Marx says that wage is also co-determined by the balance of power between workers and capitalists. as they fight out their struggle for setting the rate of exploitation. So there are, it's not subsistence, there are more factors, there's the moral and historical element, and there's also the element of class struggle. And further, another element in capital is the economic cycle. Marx says that in the ascending phases of the capitalist industrial cycle, where demand for labor power grows, the wage of the working class may be higher than the value of labor power. So at some point, it may happen that the relation of dependence between workers and capital takes on forms which are endurable for the workers. They are tolerable, or as Eden says, easy and liberal. So what happens then is that the working class is actually able, within capitalism, to extend the circle of its enjoyments. It can make additions to its consumption fund of clothes, furniture, etc., and it can even make some small savings. This is something which is in complete contradiction with the analysis in the manifesto, where he simply says, or they simply said, well, eternal pauperism or mass pauperism for everyone in the long term. So as regards the political implication, you may still remember from one of the previous slides that in the manifesto they say, well, this is ultimately what kills capitalism because it's unable to provide conditions which would be sufficient for the reproduction of the working class, and therefore the bourgeoisie is unable to rule. In Capital, the perspective is completely different. He says, well, even though the wages rise, even though the living standard of the working class rises, this doesn't really change the relation between the working class and capital in a fundamental way. It only shortens the length of the golden chain between the worker and the capitalist. It can never go as far as to threaten the system itself. I won't go into the explanation of why Marx thought it was like this. It has to do with his theory of the industrial cycle and with the role of the reserve army of labor, which somehow regulates the movements of wages so that they never really depress profits too much. Now, so in Manifesto, what we see is a theory of absolute immiseration. The living standards of the working class will fall in the long term, and this is an obstacle to continued bourgeois domination. In Capital, what we see is a theory of relative immiseration. The working class produces more and more. It perhaps appropriates more and more, but its share of the total product decreases. So it's an immiseration in relative terms. It's a theory of increasing polarization, not a theory of absolute pauperization or immiseration. And this long-term rise in workers' living standards that may occur is not an obstacle to continued bourgeois domination because it's not based on making people poorer and poorer, it's based on making people work harder and harder, to put it in a very simplified way. The third area I want to speak about very quickly, I hope I still have some time, is the way the Manifesto and Capital look at the nature of social reality in capitalism. The first part of the Manifesto contains a fascinating ode to the progress brought about by the bourgeois epoch. According to some literary theorists, the Communist Manifesto is actually the first great work of literary modernism as a celebration of modernity. And one of the things that are mentioned in this ode to progress is that the bourgeois epoch has substituted the previous modes of exploitation, which were veiled by religious and political illusions. It has substituted these forms with new forms, which are shameless, direct, brutal, and naked, in the sense that they are visible. They are right there. You just have to look at them, and you see its exploitation. And with the general social progress and with all the technological advancements and the widening of access to education, Marx and Engels thought people will be finally compelled to face with sober senses the real conditions of life that they live in. In Capital, the view is completely different. The first chapter contains this famous section on the fetishism of commodities, or on the fetish character of commodities. And there Marx shows that even the basic structures of capitalist socialization, or Vergesellschaftlichung, are mystified. They contain secrets. And so he speaks about the mystical character of the commodity or the magic of money. So to simplify it a lot, since I don't have that much time, he basically says it isn't enough to look at these things as they present themselves. We need a scientific analysis to look beyond what is immediately obvious. And this also applies to the relation between the worker and the capitalist, the relation of exploitation. While the manifesto thought that, or argued that the relation is transparent, in Capital, it's all but transparent. It's veiled by the commodity form, which makes it mystified, which makes it seem as if all of the labor done by the worker was paid. So the difference between necessary labor and surplus labor, and between paid labor and unpaid labor, becomes completely obliterated. All labor appears as paid labor, and this results in certain illusions on both the part of the worker and the capitalist about how the relation between them is fair, just, etc. Marx also contrasts this with feudalism. He says, in feudalism, it was much clearer because the feudal serf worked on the lord's land and he worked on his own land. So the difference between necessary labor and surplus labor was palpable. It was empirically visible. While in capitalism, because the relation is concealed by money and commodity relations, it's no longer visible. Everything appears as paid and fair. So while the manifesto argues that capitalism basically rationalized the social world and disenchanted it and made class domination naked, Capital argues that there are that capitalism actually mystifies the social world much more than the previous modes of production. Class domination in capitalism is veiled, and we need a scientific analysis to look beyond what's immediately obvious. So this is a brief summary of the main differences as I see them. Maybe in the discussion we can turn to the question of what are the underlying theoretical differences between the manifesto and Capital, and how we could explain these differences in economic analysis. Thank you, and sorry for not.
Skvěle. Tak děkuji Jurajovi za jeho příspěvek, a nyní je prostor pro vás. Tak se prosím přihlašte, pokud chcete mluvit, a poprosím asi Standu, aby podal zájemcům mikrofon. Děkuju moc. Tak a neváhejte. Opět budeme postupovat, jako jsme postupovali předtím, to znamená, sebereme nějaké dotazy a pak je zodpovíme.
I guess I have one brief comment and one brief question. It was interesting to observe and compare Juraj's presentation with Norbert Trenka's. In particular, it's one respect where how you point to the importance of dispossession in Capital versus the manifesto. And from that perspective, I wonder to what extent we could say that actually, in spite of maybe some rhetorical, superficial appearances, in some sense, class becomes more important to category in Capital than in the manifesto, because in the manifesto, it's, yes, there are these struggling classes, but their difference is more or less taken for granted, whereas in Capital, Marx explains the separation as a real part of the analysis. And maybe just a brief question for Gregors. I mean, you did point out, I think generally correct, and most people would agree that Marx certainly had a lot in common with liberalism in general. But on the other hand, Marx seemed to feel that in order to create something that we would later call Marxism, it had to come through this criticism of liberalism. And so where can we identify the importance of those similarities versus those differences, and how much Bentham is just an example? I mean, Marx, when he criticizes Bentham, he's just a symbol of like liberalism in general. And to what extent is there maybe something, is Bentham really important as a specific character rather than a symbol of liberalism in general?
Děkuji, Joe. Někdo další? A? Dan?
Yeah, thanks. This is a question, maybe it's not a question, maybe it's just me thinking out loud to Yoro, but because I thought that was really, really good. And I, focusing specifically on the point about social reality, this is something I've always struggled with, right? This sense that there is a, as you put it really clearly, with sober senses versus fetishized, veiled reality. And I suppose I'm wondering if we might try and bring those two points a little bit back together, because I feel like, or at least try to think about how both of those things might be true at once, right? That capitalism both veils something and also reveals something important about brutal social relations. And what comes to my mind, although I'm sure it's probably have more to say because you've been maybe thinking about it more recently, right? But is that the point in Capital where he talks about descending into production, right? So at the level of circulation, it's mystified, but as we descend into production, there is a sense in which, maybe it's putting it too strongly, but a sense in which every worker knows that when they turn up to work, they're being dominated, right? Even if the point when they, as it were, appear as equals in the market and sign the contract, then it's mystified. But then kind of when we descend into that realm of production, the minute the boss tells you what to do, it's not mystified anymore. And I wonder if, and I know that's crude, but I wonder, and so that partly because you went over it very quickly, but there's a point about kind of no kind of privileged epistemic point of view. And I wonder if maybe there is, at least in that moment, some kind of privileged epistemic point of view, right? But that's just me thinking out loud. But this troubles me too, or troubles me. I don't even know if it troubles you, but I'm interested in what you think about it.
Tak děkuju za přemýšlení na hlas. A ještě nějaký komentář, otázka, nesouhlas, zejména silný nesouhlas. A ještě Luba se zhlasila.
Perhaps this is just a comment and not a question, really, but I also started thinking about this difference of transparency and veiled character of social reality between In Capital and Manifesto. What are the political implications of these epistemologies? Because I see Capital is obviously not a text that is supposed to hegemonize a political subject or really address a particular political subject. And I believe that in order to invite someone to a political project, you really have to sort of like devise an understanding of social reality that can be something that's in the grasp of the proletarian. So I'm just thinking about like, okay, what would you think about this? The manifesto as really a political as a political text versus Capital being the more theoretical one.
Tak, děkuju a prosím řečníky, aby se chopili těch otázek a komentářů, které jsme slyšeli.
Maybe I start with the question on Bentham. For me, I wanted to start a comparison also because I think Marx had been very, very strongly associated with collectivism, and the whole history of Marxism goes in this direction. And now, since like 10 or 20 years, we got a more like historical accurate view on Marx. And so, for sure, Marx started in a liberal area or a liberal society, and he read Hegel a lot, and for Hegel, for example, it was kind of important that there's a kind of historical process, and it starts with the fight of the bourgeoisie against the aristocracy. And the bourgeoisie is the revolutionizing actor in the Communist Manifesto, and Marx would have said, yeah, for sure, formal rights for everybody are important, but they are not enough. So in this line, you can read both of them. Like Marx, Bentham started out with the fight against the aristocracy and the right for formal democratic rights. And then came Marx, and he criticized the idea of human rights and bourgeois individuality and said, okay, that's not enough. We need more than this. The formal frame is okay and good, and we need this, but we need also social chains, because if I got rights, but I've got no money, I can do nothing, but I need both of it, you know. And so I think rather you get a new perspective on Marx if you read him through Bentham and compare them both. Maybe that could be an answer.
Well, I'll start with the first question first. I think, I think the tension is real. I think it's important, but I think it's ultimately left unresolved. I think it leads also to the classical debate between whether economic struggles can develop into political struggles and how this happens. Because on the one hand, when you enter the workplace, especially if it's a properly capitalistically organized workplace, you are immediately confronted with the fact of domination. On the other hand, is it really so easy to make a connection between this and all of the other forms that are outside the workplace, perhaps, but are obviously connected to it, not obviously, but they are connected to it? I think even the later Marx oscillates between these two viewpoints, between thinking that the capitalist reality is so radically mystified that even the workers are victims of illusions about, having a fair wage for a fair day's work. And he confronts this, he tried to confront this politically by, writing, instead of this conservative motto, we have to write the revolutionary motto, abolition of the wage labor on our banners. But I think ultimately the tension between these two things, as well as between economic and political struggles, is left unresolved in Marxism. There are various approaches to resolving this. Lenin's solution is one of the more famous ones. I'm not sure it was that convincing. And I'm not if you're satisfied with the answer. I can't really give you more than these vague comments. And Luba, your question, I think I addressed it in a way now. Capital definitely wasn't a work with intentions like the manifesto was. The extent, simply in the number of pages, makes this obvious. But I also think that we shouldn't view these two works as sort of two forms of saying the same thing, because I think they really aren't. The manifesto corresponds to a completely different stage in Marx's development as a theoretician. So it's not like this is a propaganda text, this is the scientific text, but behind them there is something similar, something identical. I don't think this works, because the analysis and the implications of the analysis are too different. And I think it would be really strange if Marx would have to have been really stupid if he didn't change his ideas for 20 years. I mean, even from this very simple point of view, obviously people's ideas change as they work on topics. So it's not a weak point in Marx that he changed views. I think it's a good thing.
Děkuju za odpovědi. A další kolo otázek a komentářů. Tak jeden, druhý.
Okay, I will ask as well in English. I was thinking, I really enjoy your analysis comparing Capital and Manifesto, and I was thinking if you find as well internal contradictions within these two texts. Because, for example, for me, I feel Communist Manifesto as such has many internal discrepancies. Yeah? For example, there is this sentence that the history of all hitherto existing societies is history of class struggles, but at the same time there are these passages about the market and about that the market is a leading force. So what's the leading force of history? It's class struggles or it's market? Yeah. So this is one thing. And another thing is, if we compare both texts, would you say what is the historical impact of both of them? As far as I correct understand the existence of Marxist movement in history, Communist Manifesto had played always as a political message. Stronger role, yeah. So, and Capital was, in terms of political messages, something like lying in the shadow of Manifesto, if I'm not wrong.
Dobře, děkuju. A dozadu Norbertovi.
Yes. Yes, I agree with you, Juraj, that of course in the Capital, the central element is the fetishism of merchandise or commodity. But I would also say that fetishism is more than to veil the relationship, the social relationship. A comment to this, because fetishism in Marx also is the real process. He says that the relationship between people appear to be objective relationships, and they are objective relationships, so they take the form of things that move independently, and this makes the term of fetishism much more complex. Because we have, on the one hand, of course, people feel that they are dominated in some way, but at the same time, they say, for example, well, there are some constraints we have to accept. For example, the constraint for growth. Everybody says growth is necessary. Yes, but growth is necessary only under capitalist conditions for the accumulation of capital. But in the consciousness of people, this is like a natural law. As you have to, you will have this in every society, as well as labor. Well, everybody has to work. Everybody has to work a long time and work harder from year to year. This is like a natural law accepted, but it's part of the fetishist process of commodity production. And another way, another aspect also that then domination is, of course, people is conscious in some way that there is a domination, but they think domination not in terms of an objective process, but in the terms of personal domination. Then, for example, for all the capitalist problems, there are some groups of people that are responsible: the financial capitalists, the oligarchy, the plutocracy, and all these ways of look at capitalism are part of the fetishism, which, by the way, open the way for populism, which appeals to that, saying that, well, of course, they have a sort, populism has a sort of criticism on capitalism, but it's only focused on certain groups of people who dominate the rest of the people. And this is a false view which Marx wants to criticize with the term of fetishism. Well,
it's Rocket or somebody else. I also have this short question for the last presentation. I really appreciated your schema and your approach. I would just, to make it more interesting, to make an opposite, try to make an opposite approach. What do you think about all those tendencies in the capital where the opposite, let's say the character of the manifestation is brought up? I mean, the first phrase in the capital is that wealth of societies where the capitalist mode of production prevails appears as the commodity. So its word is erscheinen. It's actually, it's a Hegelian word from the Hegel science of logic. Means really appearing, to show something. And also in the chapter on fetishism or fetish character, actually that could be also a question. The difference, what do you think about the difference, or shall we make the difference between fetishismus and fetish character? And in your schema, actually, fetishismus will be more on the side of mystification, while fetish character will be more on the side of the appearance, because also there Marx used the words erscheinen, the commodity erscheint, appears in the form of fetish character. So we have both tendencies actually in Capital. So that.
I agree on some points Juraj made, but I would like to focus on two similarities between the manifesto and Capital. Can you find some ones in the respect? I can pay attention to the tendency to concentration or centralization of capital in the manifesto and in Capital, and other common traits to difference the principal difference between these two texts can be seen to be the invention of the concept of value, and the manifesto was written before this invention, the conceptual event, as Althusser put it. And I would say that the manifesto prepared the condition of appearance to concept of value. And to Martin Brabec, my question is. The authors you mentioned worked on the problems of accumulation, first accumulation, or to problems concerning merchandise, but I would like pay attention to another concept that is the one by Fernando Braudel, who coined the term the financial capital as an origin of the of capitalism. The financial capital was the capital of the bankers such as Fugger's family.
Děkuju. Tak a opět neváhejte řečníci chopit se těch témat. Nevím, jestli většina jich šla na Juraje, tak chutě.
Okay, I think first was Stanislaw, right? You asked about the tensions within the manifesto. I agree with the illustration you made. I think there are plenty tensions in Capital. Ultimately, I think they stem from the fact that Marx never finished Capital, that the second and the third volume remained manuscripts at different stages of being finished. I'm quite sympathetic to the thesis by Michael Heinrich, who says that there's a Ricardian ambivalence in Capital, that the way the theory of value is explained in the first volume is actually a more advanced stage of that theory than in the third volume, where Marx tries to make like a quantitative procedure of transforming values into production prices. This would open up a whole can of worms. I don't want to go to this debate, but I would say that there are important tensions inside Capital as a text or as a work. I also think I agree with what you said about the historical role of these texts. There's a fascinating study, I forgot the name of the author, but it's called Did They Read Marx? And it was written by this historian who looked at reading habits of German SPD members at the beginning of the 20th century. To what extent did they actually read Marx? To what extent was Engels important, and to what extent all these party popularizers of Marxism were important? And he basically finds that the only text that was read by Marx by rank and file SPD members was the Manifesto. Capital was mostly known through popularizations by Kautsky and by others. So yeah, the historical role of these two texts was I think very, very different, maybe to the detriment of the whole enterprise. I also agree with the comments made by Mr. Trenkle. I agree that fetishism is not simply ideology or illusion. I think it has a real substance, and it's the consequence of the very way in which social labor is organized in capitalism. I agree with this. This also relates to the next question, that I didn't differentiate between fetish character and fetishismus. This is because I was struggling with this a bit, because the English translation, and I did the presentation in English, the English translation of the first volume uses fetishism of commodities for the title of the fourth section of the first chapter, whereas in German it's the fetish character, the Ware. So yeah, I agree that there's something very palpable behind the illusions, and this is the way a commodity economy is organized, which produces these irrational, inverted forms of thought. And this is also the reason why I think the capitalist reality is more mystified than pre-capitalist reality, because the illusions do not come from outside. They are not forced onto people by priests or by, you know, the evil aristocrats or anything like that. They stem from the very actions of the social agents themselves, who reproduce these forms of thought and feel at home in these forms of thought. And the last question was about similarities between Manifesto and Capital. I think we could find some. I mean, obviously, the great description of the emergence of capitalism and its ability to dominate everywhere, to destroy all barriers and to become dominant wherever it enters. I think this is something that was also present in later Marx. But I think there are many other differences between the Manifesto and the later Marx that I didn't mention, because they're not as much related to Capital as to other works. For example, when the Manifesto was published in German for the second time, which I think was 1872, Marx and Engels wrote a new preface, which is very interesting, because already at that time they say this document is mostly of historical importance. It's not really... if we would write it today, it would look very different from the way we wrote it 14 years or more than 14 years ago. For example, the 10 demands about nationalizing the industry and taking control of the state would look very different. And this was a result of Marx's study of the Paris Commune, obviously, where he comes to the famous conclusion that the proletariat can't just expropriate the state machinery and use it for its own purposes. It must destroy the state machinery. And in the manifesto, it's quite clearly more about seizing the machinery than destroying it. Another great area of differences relates to the first Russian edition of the manifesto, which was, I think, 1882. And they wrote a preface and they said, well, today the main question as concerning Russia is whether a revolution in Russia against absolutism, against czarism, could become a signal for a proletarian revolution in the West. And if this happens, then perhaps Russia doesn't have to go through the whole ordeal of capitalist development, but the Russian peasant commune, the Mir, could become the basis of a post-capitalist or communist development in Russia. So that, Manifesto has this very linear view of historical development. Feudalism is destroyed, and on its ruins, capitalism appears and it dominates everything. But in the preface to the Russian edition, as well as in the letters to Viera Zasulich and some other writings about Russia, Marx is very clear that he abandoned this linear vision and thought about in more detail how these pre-capitalist forms could actually provide an impulse to future development. So I think there are more ways of looking at the manifesto as an obsolete document from the point of view of Marx's later theory. And it's not just from the point of view of capital, but also of other studies that Marx made.
Ještě otázka na Martina.
Pokud jde o roli o peněz, finančníků, pokud jsem tě dobře rozuměl, tak když to řeknu hodně natvrdo, tak při zrodu kapitalismu podle politického marxismu neměli žádný vliv. Ten důležitý vliv je právě závislost výrobců na trhu. To dělá z kapitalismus, protože ti výrobci se musí řídit imperativem trhu. A imperativ trhu říká akumulovat, snižovat náklady, zlepšovat výrobu. Pokud nemáme tenhle aspekt, tak role peněz tam nebude hrát nějakou kvalitativní roli. Může se podívat na různé předkapitalistické typy ekonomik, společenských systémů, kde role peněz také byla určitě. Najdeme tam roli nějakých finančníků při obchodech. Ale ti nějak tu výrobu nějakým způsobem nezefektivněli tak, jako to zefektivní právě ty kapitalistické výrobní vztahy díky tomu imperativu trhu. Jo? Samozřejmě ty peníze jsou tam nějak důležité, takže můžeme říci, že třeba vliv peněz rozšiřoval ještě ty kapitalistické vztahy, více zdynamizoval. Ale ten klíčový rys je prostě ta závislost všech těch výrobců, těch ekonomických subjektů na tom trhu.
Děkuji za odpověď. Tak a pokud by někdo chtěl, tak poslední komentář, otázka, nesouhlas. A pokud tomu tak není, nevidím žádnou zdviženou ruku, která by se hlásila o slovo, tak já bych poděkoval všem třem našim panelistům za jejich příspěvky, za jejich odpovědi na otázky a komentáře, vám za otázky a komentáře a uvidíme se v 17:00 na závěrečném panelu naší dnešní konference a děkuji vám za pozornost.